Okay, let's get started. Good morning, all of you. Any questions from last class? Please note that in the last class, we looked at higher order elements for one-dimensional problems. And also, we have seen application of those elements for general one-dimensional boundary value problem. And also, we have seen how to apply those elements for solving column buckling problem to find the critical buckling load. Okay, and with that, you should be able to solve assignment 5, whatever we completed, and that will be all included in second quiz, which is going to be which is scheduled on Saturday 24th. Next Saturday, 24th of April. Okay. So in today's class, we need to progress further. So as a part of that, we'll be looking at two-dimensional problems. But please note that unless your foundation for one-dimensional problem is proper, you will not be able to understand two-dimensional problems. So I suggest all of you take the assignment seriously. Please complete assignment 5 at the earliest, anyway that is required for your quiz, second quiz. So with that, let me start. So the next topic is this one. Here, for two-dimensional case, we'll directly look at a general two-dimensional boundary value problem. And once you have the element equations, you can decide the type of element you want to use for solving the problem. So here, we'll first look at triangular elements. Okay. Anyway, you please take a note of this two-dimensional boundary value problem. And you can read the statement here. A large class of two-dimensional problems is governed by a boundary value problem of the following general form. So most of the two-dimensional boundary value problem that you are going to encounter in your structural mechanics, they fall into, or they can be expressed in this form. So this is the differential equation. And please note that now it's a two-dimensional domain. So the domain is an arbitrary shaped domain is what is shown here. An arbitrary shaped domain is what is shown here. Over this domain, this is a two-dimensional domain, x-axis, y-axis. And this is the area in which this differential equation needs to be satisfied, subjected to some boundary conditions. And this is the area of this two-dimensional domain is denoted with this capital A. And the surface, the boundary of this area is denoted with this S. S is the boundary of that area. N is the outward normal at any point on the boundary. If you take any point on the boundary, outward normal. Normal that is pointing outward at that particular location on the domain, and that normal keeps changing as you shift the point. Let's say here the normal is shown at this particular point, and if you go to some other point, normal is going to be pointing in some other direction. Okay, so please take a note of this problem statement. And T is the field variable. Similar to what we have seen for one-dimensional, general one-dimensional boundary value problem, except that field variable here is function of both x and y. Okay. Similarly, all these coefficients are functions of x and y. Please take a note of this. S is the boundary of this domain. This A is the area of this domain over which we need to solve this differential equation. S comprises of two parts. S comprises of two parts. Part of the boundary can be like, you know, you can specify essentially. Any questions? So please take a note of this problem statement. And please also look at the order of the differential equation. This is a second order differential equation because you have the second highest derivative that is appearing in second order. Okay. I hope you have taken note of this. So let me proceed further. So that particular differential equation, we need to solve over the two-dimensional domain A, and is the boundary of this domain is S. As I just mentioned, part of the boundary, essential boundary conditions can be specified on other part of the boundary, natural boundary conditions can be specified. So that is what is mentioned here. On the boundary S, either the field variable is specified or its derivative is specified. Derivative is nothing but your field variable is nothing but your essential boundary condition. Derivative of field variable is nothing but natural boundary condition. So that is what is mentioned. Because it's a second order differential equation, those boundary conditions of order 0 are essential boundary condition. Those boundary conditions of order 1 are natural boundary conditions. So based on that, if it is not second order differential equation, then this statement is not valid. Okay. On the boundary S, either the field variable is specified or its derivative is specified. That means either essential boundary condition is specified or natural boundary condition is specified. Okay. Let total S, which is the surface, let's divide it into two parts, S1 and S2. Let S1 is equal to part of the boundary on which T is specified, field variable is specified. And S2 is part of boundary on which first derivative of T is specified. That is nothing but natural boundary conditions. So if you agree with that kind of this one, S1 and S2, dividing this boundary into two parts, then we can write like this. The possible boundary conditions can then be expressed as like this. T is equal to field variable value, T is equal to T naught at some point xy on S1. S1 is essential boundary condition. And the derivative of t is not with respect to x or y, it's with respect to the normal. Derivative of t is with respect to the normal. Okay, derivative of t with respect to normal multiplied by this k plus alpha as a function of x and y times t plus beta as function of x and y is equal to 0. This is a general form of natural boundary condition. It is specified on S2. And what is this derivative of t with respect to the normal? What is this? That is nothing but this one. This relation, derivative of t with respect to normal, this relation of this with respect to x and y is obtained from coordinate transformation. Okay, if you see how the coordinates are transformed, then you can understand this one. We will discuss further on this later. So derivative of t, k times derivative of t with respect to normal is nothing but kx derivative of t with respect to x. This normal has two components. Component of normal in x direction, component of normal in y direction. So multiply here, nx is nothing but component of x, component of n in x direction. That is what is mentioned, in which nx, ny are components of unit outer normal, outward normal on the boundary. And normal is a vector. It's a two-dimensional vector. It can be expressed like this. N is equal to nx times I. I is unit vector along x direction. Ny times unit vector along y direction. Nx, ny are nothing but component of n along x direction, component of n along y direction. That is this. That's why I'm saying, please take a note of this. Otherwise, it's going to be confusing. Please take a note of this. So now we have the governing differential equation that we need to solve over the domain A, which is a two-dimensional domain subjected to the boundary conditions. Okay? And now we are free to use either Galerkin method or variational method. So we need to decide whether we want to use Galerkin method or variational method. As you can see here, just now whatever we covered for two-dimensional case, things are getting complicated. Especially you can see here, I don't know, you are feeling the intensity of this kind of thing. Here, you can see the it's getting complicated. So it's always test our understanding of a topic related to finite element. It is better always to check whether our understanding is proper or not for one-dimensional problems. That is the reason we spend a lot of time on one-dimensional problems. And once your understanding is clear for one-dimensional problems, then extension of it for two-dimensional and three-dimensional problems is not that difficult. So anyway, you please take a note of it and take whatever I'm explaining, take it seriously, okay? So now we got the governing differential equation that we need to solve subjected to the boundary conditions. So we need to decide whether we want to adopt a Galerkin method or variational method. Okay? Let's say we want to adopt Galerkin method. Variational method. Let's say we want to adopt variational method. What we need to do is, we need to take this governing differential equation, multiply on either side of this equation with variation of field variable t, which is going to be function of x and y here in this particular two-dimensional case, integrate over the problem domain, multiply with variation of t, integrate over the problem domain, which is two-dimensional case, and apply integration by parts, all that kind of thing you need to repeat here. But in addition to integration by parts in two-dimensional problems, you are going to see application of Green's theorem. Green's theorem is, you must have studied as a part of your mathematics, if you studied properly. Otherwise, the advantage of using Green's theorem is, you can reduce the problem dimension. Suppose you have a two-dimensional integral over a two-dimensional area that can be converted into integral over the surface. Suppose you have an integral over this area, that integral you can convert into integral over this boundary. Similarly, if you have an integral over a three-dimensional surface, a three-dimensional body, then it can be converted into integral over let's say if you have a cube, cube has six faces. So instead of integrating over the entire volume of the cube, you can integrate on all the six faces, six surfaces. So three-dimensional integrals can be converted into two-dimensional integral. Two-dimensional integral can be converted into one-dimensional integral by using Green's theorem along with integration by parts. So that's what we are going to use for two-dimensional problems. Okay. So that is a new thing that you are going to learn. So the procedure is this differential equation, you need to multiply with variation of t, which is function of x and y. Integrate over this two-dimensional problem. And that you need to do on either side. Since here on this right-hand side, you have this zero. So here, whatever you do, it's going to be zero. So once that is the first step, next step is integration by parts along with Green's theorem. And then you need to simplify. Okay, finally you need to express your the given problem into equivalent variational functional. That is nothing but variation of something inside the bracket is equal to zero. You need to bring into that form, and whatever is inside the bracket with variational symbol out, that whatever quantity is inside, that is nothing but equivalent variational functional. And that equivalent variational functional, we are going to substitute finite element approximation, and then apply the stationarity conditions to get the element equations in variational method. So this is the procedure that we followed in one-dimensional problem. Same thing we are going to follow here, except that you are going to have additional that Green's theorem. Okay, so that is the procedure. And if you adopt that procedure, okay, and finally, if you bring the given problem, or if you are able to cast the given problem into the form variation of something inside the bracket is equal to zero, whatever that is there inside the bracket that is equal and functional, that functional for this problem and these boundary conditions, that looks like this. Just let me show you that before we see the other things. The equivalent functional for the boundary value problem is directly given here. Okay, you please take a note of it. Equivalent functional for this two-dimensional general two-dimensional boundary value problem that we just looked at, that we just noted the differential equation and boundary conditions, and if you adopt variational method and do all that manipulation, algebraic manipulation, and finally you are going to get this as equivalent variational functional. Please take a note of it. So this is what we need to get before we proceed and substitute finite element approximation. Once we get equivalent functional, you substitute finite element approximation of this derivative of t with respect to x, derivative of t with respect to y, and finite element approximation of t, all that, and apply the stationarity conditions. Then you are going to get element equations. Okay? So for the given whatever problem we started out in today's class, for that equivalent functional is this. And please note that it's like something I told you, if you follow the procedure and finally you are going to get this equivalent functional. So you don't need to believe me. You don't need to believe me. Or in fact, you should not believe that. You need to verify really whatever I am saying is correct or not. Okay? So here, we also, as a part of this exercise, we also learn if equivalent functional is given for a problem, how to check whether that equivalent functional is correct one for that problem or not. So that also we are going to learn in today's class. Okay? So please take a note of this equivalent functional, and also take a note of what is this derivative of t subscript or this comma x, what actually it means? It's nothing but partial derivative of t with respect to x. T comma y is nothing but partial derivative of t with respect to y, because t is function of x and y. Okay, any questions here? So this is the equivalent functional for that problem. And also we noted that here S2 is that this integral is only on S2. S2 is nothing but here note that the second integral is evaluated over S2 only. That is the part of the boundary over which natural boundary condition is specified. So this is the equivalent functional for the problem that we started in today's class. And don't take it for granted. You need to check it. That how to check it is what is given here. So whatever you are going to see here, that you can go back and apply for one-dimensional problems as well. So to verify whether this t as a function, I as a function of t, is the correct functional. Okay. This is how you got this one when you took the given problem and then applied all the variational identities and all those variational formulas and then manipulating it and bringing into the form variation of I as a function of t is equal to zero. That is how you got this one. That means variation of this should be equal to zero. That is the first step we are going to apply. So to verify whether this I as a function of t is correct functional, we must show that first variation of I is zero when the boundary value problem is satisfied. You apply variation, you take variation of this I equated to zero. This can be done by the following essentially the same steps as those for one-dimensional problems. But we are going in the reverse direction. So this functional is there. You take variation of it, equate it to zero. So variation of this, you just take variational operator inside. Variation operator is not going to operate on kx. Variation operator is going to operate only derivative of t with respect to x square. You apply the variation operator, there is half here, then this is going to become derivative of t with respect to x times variation of derivative of t with respect to x, this one. Similarly, this one, you apply variation operator, half is there. When you apply variation operator on t square, it's going to be t times variation of t, and here it's going to be variation of t, and subsequently all the things you can cross it. So this is the first step. And now you apply integration by parts. Integration by parts in the reverse direction. Interchanging the order of differentiation and variation in the first two terms. Interchanging order of differentiation here. Before we do that, here it is written as variation of derivative of t with respect to x. Variation of derivative of t with respect to x is same as derivative of variation of t. So that is what is mentioned. Interchanging the order of differentiation and variation in the first two terms results in this equation. Rest of the terms are all same. And this integral is over S2. So please take a note of it. You just don't watch the video and keep quiet. You please take a note of it in your notebook. Okay, I hope you have taken note of this last equation. Now we need to apply integration by parts. please note that here derivative is operating on variation of t. And also please note that we are going in the reverse direction. So this derivative needs to be transferred to here. This derivative, instead of operating on variation of t, it has to be transferred to kx times derivative of t with respect to x. Similarly, same thing here. So we are going to apply integration by parts. You know how to apply integration by parts to transfer this derivative over these two terms. You know, already know that. But in addition to that, we are going to apply Green's theorem. And what is this Green's theorem that we'll see? Before that, I hope you have taken note of this equation, because it's very difficult for me to back and forth come to this equation. Okay? I hope you have taken note of it. So the next step is shift this differentiation operator over these two terms. So to do that, you need to apply integration by parts. And integration, when you apply integration by parts, you are going to get additional terms, okay? Additional two terms are going to come in. So that is what this one. And what are these terms? What are these two terms? That is all coming from Green's theorem. You can take a note of this Green's theorem. Before you understand this one, you take a note of this Green's theorem. Okay? So here, you have a two-dimensional integral. You have a variable u multiplied by partial derivative of v with respect to x. Why it is partial derivative here? Why it's not full derivative? Because v is function of x and y. You are taking derivative only with respect to x. You need to be very clear on that, okay? U and v are two variables. U is function of x and y. V is also function of x and y. Whereas here you are taking derivative with respect to x alone. So you have a two-dimensional integral, u times derivative of v with respect to x, that u need to integrate over this area. And if you apply integration by parts, how you are going to get, what you are going to get integration by parts? You shift the derivative to u, so that is the first term. Shift the derivative to u, and derivative on v is released. Plus you have derivative, if it is integration by parts alone, it's going to be this term, whatever term this is there. If you wanted to write in terms of area, please take a note of it. It's going to be partial derivative with respect to x inside the bracket, it's going to be integral, area integral, two-dimensional integral, integral uv dA. It's going to be uv dA. And Green's theorem, what Green's theorem says is, if you have an integral like that, please take a note of it. Two-dimensional integral, you need to write like this. Two-dimensional integral. And the integrand is partial derivative with respect to x of uv dA. Okay? What this Green's theorem says is, when you are taking derivative with respect to x, then you are taking partial derivative with respect to x and integrating product of u and v over the area, it's going to be same as, it's going to be same as surface integral, it's going to be same as surface integral of the product uv, product uv multiplied by the unit normal, x component of unit normal. Okay, x component of unit normal, because you are taking derivative with respect to x. So this is what, please note that this is Green's, even though it's written as Green's theorem, this entire thing is integration by parts along with Green's theorem. This quantity is actually coming from Green's theorem. Please note that here this formula is written for area integral. Here, this is an area integral, two-dimensional integral. And here, two-dimensional integral is converted into surface integral, line integral. And same thing can be extended for three-dimensional case. In case of three-dimensional, this is going to be volume integral. Instead of line integral here, you are going to have area integral. So if you understood whatever I just explained, and if you have taken note in your notebook, this is with respect to x, and same thing you can do it with respect to y. When you have derivative with respect to y, partial derivative with respect to y, here it's going to be component of n in the y direction. Because this is derivative with respect to y, component of n in y direction. Please take a note of this. So this is what is Green's theorem, integration by parts in two dimensions. Integration by parts along with Green's theorem. So if you understood these two equations, these two formulas, one is illustrating partial derivative with respect to x, second one is illustrating partial derivative with respect to y. If you understood these two terms, or two formulas, apply these two formulas here. These two terms. When you apply on this, you are going to get one area integral and one line integral. Here also one area integral, one line integral. So if you do that, you are going to get this. That line integral that is going to result in is this. Please take a note of this. And now to further simplify, if you use admissible trial solution, you please recall what you learned as a part of one-dimensional boundary value problem or one-dimensional problems. When you take admissible trial solution, then admissible trial solution, the variation of admissible trial solution over the essential boundary condition is going to be zero. So that is what is written here. If the trial solution are required to satisfy essential boundary condition, then variation of t is equal to 0 over s1. Or in other words, if you use admissible trial solution, automatically variation of t is going to be 0 on s1. S1 is the part of the boundary over which essential boundary conditions are specified. So why this condition is highlighted here? Because you can see here this integral is over S. This integral is over S. So instead of integral, this S, integral over S can be split into two things. Integral over S1 plus integral over S2. Similarly, integral over S1 plus integral over S2. And looking at integral over S1, you have this quantity nx. Nx is nothing but normal component in the x direction. Kx is the coefficient, derivative of t with respect to x, multiplied by variation of t. And when your integral is over S1, variation of t is going to be zero. Okay, so these two terms, in fact, you don't need to integrate over S. It is enough if you integrate over S2, because variation of t over S1 is going to be zero. So for that, this is noted. So this you can replace it as S2 and S2. Once you replace this as S2 and S2, you can combine these three terms. This one, this one, this one. Okay? So that is what is written here. And finally, whatever we started, variation of y is this one. And this variation of y should be equal to zero. If this is the correct functional, when I take variation of it should be equal to zero. So far we have not applied that condition. It should be equal to zero. Now we can apply that condition. So this variation of I should be equal to zero. When this variation of I can be equal to zero, let's say you have A plus B is equal to C. C is equal to zero. C is equal to zero, and A and B are not, linearly dependent. Then A should be independently equal to zero, B should be independently equal to zero, then only C is going to be zero. So that is the condition we are going to apply. So variation of y is equal to zero, that is possible if this is equal to zero, this is equal to zero. What is this equal to zero? That results. What is this equal to zero? I told you in the beginning of this today's class, you take a note of the problem statement. I don't know whether you have taken note of it or seriously or not. If you equate this to zero, then it is nothing but your starting differential equation. If you equate this to zero, that is nothing but your natural boundary condition. So in fact, this variation or equivalent functional is actually representing this problem. That is how you can verify. This variational, that equivalent functional is representing this problem, because finally in the variation of u, this differential equation is appearing and also this natural boundary condition is appearing. So this is how, given a variant equivalent functional, if somebody asks you to verify whether that equivalent variational functional is correct functional for a given problem or not, this is the procedure you need to adopt. Okay? Any questions here? So this exercise, what you learned is, first thing is Green's theorem. Second one is, given the equivalent functional, how do I verify whether it is correct functional for the given problem or not? So this is another way of doing things. Usually what we did for one-dimensional boundary value problem, you started with the differential equation, you multiplied with variation of t on either side, and you went through all that, and then finally you got equivalent functional. But here it is in the reverse direction. Somebody already gave the equivalent functional. Or if it is a structural mechanics problem, at least a civil engineers, if their foundation is good, they can directly write this equivalent functional. If their foundation of structural analysis, mechanics of materials, all those basic fundamentals are good, they can directly write this equivalent functional. After writing the equivalent functional, if you want to verify whether that is correct or not, this is the procedure you can follow. Okay. Anyway, I think I explained enough on this. So now we got this equivalent functional. We verified this equivalent functional is the correct functional. So then what is the next step? We need to decide on the finite element approximation. To decide on the finite element approximation, please note that we just started two-dimensional problems. We need to see what kind of element, what are the various elements that are there. How do I derive the shape function for those elements? So we need to focus more on that. So that is what we are going to do in the next two or three classes. We'll look at various elements that are available, okay? And then we apply the finite element approximation. So let's come back to this one. This is a differential equation. These are the boundary conditions. And what it is saying here, the problem is an extension of one-dimensional boundary value, one-dimensional problem presented in chapter 6, which is previous chapter or previous lectures. The finite element formulation follows same steps as before with one exception. In one-dimensional problems, there is no choice for the shape of an element. All elements were line elements. In two-dimensional, however, there are many possibilities for element shapes. Some possible element shape for two-dimensional problems are shown here. Triangular element, rectangular element, quadrilateral, square, triangle with curved edges or curved sides, quadrilateral with curved sides. Some of the possibilities for shapes of two-dimensional elements. Okay? So we need to derive the shape functions for all these elements, isoparametric mapping for all these elements before we proceed and substitute into this equivalent functional. Please note that here derivative of t with respect to x is the derivative of t with respect to x is there. You already learned as a part of your one-dimensional problems, derivative of t with respect to x can be expressed in terms of chain rule. In case of one-dimensional problem, it is derivative of t with respect to s multiplied by derivative of s with respect to x. That is how you approximate derivative of t with respect to x. Similarly, derivative of t with respect to y. In case of two-dimensional boundary value problem, it's going to be a chain rule, but a chain rule in two dimensions. And also Jacobian. Jacobian, I told you, in case of one-dimensional problems, a line element Jacobian is a scalar quantity. In two-dimensional problem, Jacobian is going to be a matrix. So all that we need to learn before we proceed and work on this to get the element equations. So for that, what we'll do is, we will not take all the elements at a time. We'll look at one element. We'll start with triangular elements. Derive the shape functions for triangular elements. Derive the all that derivative quantities for triangular elements. Substitute in the equivalent functional and get the element equations. Once you understood for triangular elements, you can easily extend for rectangular and other kinds of elements. Okay, so that is the path we are going to take in the next few classes. The rectangular and square elements are not very useful for general application. They can model only the rectangular solution domains accurately. The triangular and the quadrilateral elements are very versatile. They can model any two-dimensional shape with straight line boundaries. Okay. Elements with curved sides are effective in accurately representing domains with curved boundaries. We are not going to have please note that the actual element can be curved element, but even if the actual element is curved element, we are going to map onto a parent element which is going to be having straight edges. That is all what we are going to learn. Okay. The triangular elements is the simplest to formulate and is presented immediately. Since it is based on linear polynomial trial solutions in two dimensions, the required integrations are fairly simple to carry out in closed form. Please note that two-node line element, what you learn, two-node bar element, what you learn, it's a linear element. When you take derivative of the field variable, it's going to be a constant. And if the field variable is displacement, derivative of displacement is going to be strain. I told you two-node element, linear element, it is a constant strain element. Okay? And what did we start with when we are deriving two-node element? We started with u of x is equal to a naught plus a1x. That is the trial solution we started. Similarly, in case of triangular element, for two-dimensional case, we are going to start with a trial solution in two dimensions. Trial solution in two dimensions, how it's going to be? U of xy is equal to a naught plus a1x plus a2y. A naught plus a1x plus a2y. Please see that equation. That's a linear equation in two dimensions. And when you take derivative of that equation, linear equation, you are going to get a constant. So triangular element, three-node triangular element is going to be a, or it's also called constant strain triangular element, okay? And also whenever you have this three-node triangular element, when you take derivative, it's going to be constant. So all the integrals, everything are going to be simple. That's what is the meaning of this. Since it is based on linear polynomial trial solution in two dimensions, the required integrations are fairly simple to carry out in closed form. Okay? The quadrilateral element and element with curved boundaries are formulated using isoparametric concept. And this formulation we are going to see in the next few classes. Okay? So we are going to start with triangular element. Any questions here? Anyway, I'm not going to start the triangular element. I'm going to start it on Thursday, okay, 15th. If you have any questions, please let me know. And also, I want to highlight the importance of your fundamentals in one-dimensional problems, one-dimensional element formulations. All that is all important now. If you have not done it, if you have not understood properly, and we don't have classes tomorrow and after tomorrow because of the holidays, public holidays, okay? And I think you have two New Years tomorrow. Some of the state people, tomorrow is New Year. Again on Wednesday, for some other people, New Year is there. And Happy New Year. And you spend this break of 2 days in revising one-dimensional concepts and try to complete assignment 5. Okay? And then if you do that, you will be ready to understand this triangular element. So I'm going to stop here. And if you have any questions, let me know. Otherwise, we'll close the class. Let me take attendance. Somebody is raising the hand. What is this? Who is this? Tulsi Ram. Any questions?
No, sir. By mistake, it got blocked.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. If you don't have any questions, thank you. We'll meet in on Thursday 15th.
Thank you, sir.